একটা যে
Hello everybody. Good afternoon to all. Welcome back to another online lecture. We thank you all for joining us today. I am Srinivas Pikonda, curator at Birla Industrial and Technological Museum, a unit of National Council of Science Museum, Ministry of Culture, Government of India. I will coordinate today's lecture session. During the talk, we are going to talk topic related questions for the speaker using the chat option, and a few of them will be answered toward the end of the session. This lecture is jointly organized by Birla Industrial and Technological Museum and Calcutta Consortium on Human Genetics. With this, I welcome the Secretary, Calcutta Consortium on Human Genetics, and Assistant Professor at National Institute of Biomedical Genomics, Dr. Srikanta Goswami, to kindly take over the session.
Thank you, Mr. Srinu. Yeah, it is my privilege to introduce our organization, Calcutta Consortium of Human Genetics, commonly known as CCHUGE. Right from its inception in 2008, CCHUGE, formed and run by scientists and research scholars of various research institutes and universities in and around Kolkata, has been working relentlessly to promote various outreach activities through organization of summer and winter schools, conferences, meetings, quiz, debate, etc. The main objective is to impart education and instill enthusiasm among students about human genetics and genomics. To accelerate this, recently we have teamed up with Birla Industrial and Technological Museum, Kolkata, which is also engaged in popularizing and promoting science, especially among the youth. As a part of this collaboration, today's webinar has been organized. I'm grateful to the director, BITM, for encouraging collaboration with CCHUGE. And now, I would like to request Mr. Srinu Appakonda to introduce our speaker of this afternoon, Dr. Devajyoti Chakraborty, who is the brain behind developing a rapid paper strip-based test for detecting SARS-CoV-2. Mr. Srinu, please.
I'm extremely happy to introduce today's speaker. As we all know that this year Nobel Prize in Chemistry was awarded jointly to Drs. Emmanuel Charpentier and Jennifer Doudna for the development of a method for genome editing. Today, we shall learn from Dr. Devajyoti Chakraborty how their seminal research work revolutionized genome editing. Dr. Devajyoti Chakraborty is a senior scientist at CSIR, Institute of Genomics and Integrative Biology, New Delhi, and also Assistant Professor, Faculty of Biological Sciences, Academy of Scientific and Innovative Research. Dr. Chakraborty obtained his PhD in Molecular Biology in 2014 from Max Planck Institute of Molecular Cell Biology and Genetics and Technical University, Dresden, Germany. He did his postdoctoral research work at Biotechnology JETRM, Medical Faculty, Technical University, Dresden. Dr. Chakraborty is also the recipient of many awards and fellowships, including European Molecular Biology Organization Young Investigator, Indian National Science Academy Young Scientist Award, CSIR Young Scientist Award, Merck Young Scientist Award, and also Lady Tata Trust Young Investigator Award. He has many research publications in national and international journals. So with this, may I now request Dr. Devajyoti Chakraborty to deliver his lecture titled Rewriting the Code of Life. Sir, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Appakonda and Srikanta. I'll first share my screen and then you can let me know if you can see.
Yeah, sir, it is visible.
Okay.
It will, but you have to make it full screen.
It should be fine now, right?
As a two slides are seen, sir. Two slides.
Okay. Is this better?
Yes, it's fine. Absolutely fine.
Okay, so good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much to the organizers for inviting me for this session. I have been told that this is a very prestigious series which is going on, and really it's a big honor that you asked me to come and present here today, because I think I'm a very, very small scientist, so I'm still kind of learning in this field. So, but nevertheless, I work on genome editing, and that's probably why I have been, asked today to talk a little bit about the work that is going on in life, in our lab here. Actually, doesn't matter if I say work going on in life, because that's most of the time that's what takes part of our schedule. And I call it rewriting the code of life, because for a long period of time, we used to think that humans generally are a product of their genes, and they come with a set of gene sequences into this world, and that is all that they have to live with. If you think about making changes in that DNA sequence, then indeed you are actually rewriting the code in some manner. It used to be almost thinking in terms of science fiction several years back. But thanks to genome editing, thanks to all the developments that have happened in the field of genome editing, this is no more science fiction. It's a truth. It's a reality. And as some of the exciting work that has even come as early as late as this week itself in New England Journal of Medicine, when the first trials using genome editing for hemoglobinopathy shows a lot of success, it tells us how powerful this technology is. And the field of CRISPR, as you probably know very well, this is a webinar series following on the footsteps of the Nobel Prize, has two very prominent heroes who incidentally received virtually, they did not attend the Nobel Prize session in Sweden, but actually received the Nobel Prize yesterday. They were in the news. Emmanuel Charpentier and Jennifer Doudna, who has been, they have really literally transformed the way that genome editing is looked at in terms of ease, in terms of simplicity, in terms of what can actually be done with respect to playing around with our genomes. And that's the Nobel Prize that has been awarded to them for the development of a method for genome editing. But I purposefully put this slide over here and the word two heroes to kind of just re-emphasize that, like many other things in science, it's very wrong to say that a particular field is entirely discovered and developed by only certain individuals, because there is work that several scientists over decades actually put behind it. And so is the field of CRISPR. And hence CRISPR is actually, if you really look at how the field has progressed from the 80s to what is happening at the moment, there are several heroes. Of course, the work done by Emmanuel Charpentier and Jennifer Doudna actually showed how you can put all these things together in a format that makes genome editing very, very easy. But the knowledge which has been generated over decades of research, as in any other field, is something that we really need to sometimes sit back and appreciate. And one of the people, this is from an image that somebody shared on Twitter. I found it very nice, because it kind of lists different people who have been who have been involved in this whole process from the 80s onwards. There are actually Indians as well. You can see Prashant Mali at the third row, actually, the fourth row, who has also been been the author of a pioneering paper on CRISPR during the first few years when this revolution started, 2012, 2013, when the first genome editing papers came out. So CRISPR getting the Nobel Prize was never a question. It was really, the question was when and who, because there was also the debate about the work from done by Church Group, Feng Zhang's group, and so on. But I think everybody is quite happy that as with a lot of other things in 2020, it has really been the year of women in diverse fields, whether it is women in science or whether it is women in politics. It is it's really, you know, it's a telltale signature that, you know, at least one can very confidently say that this is probably the time that we have started appreciating and really giving the right due, in at least in the case of women in the Nobel Prize field. So a very heartening decision, but it's also probably a time that we kind of understand how this all came about. And that's why, you know, this person has put up the picture of a bacteriophage and an archaea and a bacteria right on the top, because they really gave the clues for where CRISPR started from. It's now almost, you know, you can almost imagine that it's no point thinking of the bacteria and the archaea as microorganisms or simply microorganisms, because they apparently sometimes can be very, very smart as humans or even more. I mean, look at SARS-CoV-2, a virus has almost stopped the entire civilization. That was extremely exciting for researchers, and was to understand how bacterial immunity plays a role in its defense mechanisms. And that's where the origins of CRISPR actually came about. So this is a slide, I think, was taken from one of Jennifer Doudna's presentations, which shows how the whole thing happens in terms of the bacterial CRISPR system, where when a bacteriophage, which is a foreign virus which attacks a bacterial cell, it comes in and it puts its DNA inside the bacterial cell. This DNA, normally what happens is that this DNA is then goes on to make several virions, and the virus multiplies, it breaks open the cell, goes on and infects another cell. But sometimes the bacteria are very smart, and they actually take a piece of this DNA of this invading bacteriophage, and it puts it in its own genome at a very defined location. It's almost as if you can imagine that there is a librarian sitting over there, and a new book comes in, and you need to catalog that book well, because if you do not catalog that book, put in a number, an accession number or something like that, you will not be able to locate that once more. So the bacteria also does a very similar kind of a job. It puts a label, or it labels that entire DNA piece, puts it in a specific location in its library of genes, so that next time the same virus attacks the bacteria, as you see on the right side, on the you know, you can see the bacteriophage attacking. Once that virus comes in again, it quickly assembles a very complex mixture of protein and RNA, RNA and protein into a complex, which can then go and really, you know, bind to that invading DNA of the bacteriophage and chop it into small pieces. So this is an RNA-guided targeting, or an RNA-guided immunity, which is happening because there is a pre-existing piece of information in the bacterial cell telling that, yes, this virus had attacked me before. Imagine how smart that is, how elegant that is. It almost is like the immunity that we develop. And I think immunity and the idea of immunity going towards a vaccine is now almost, you know, household knowledge because of SARS-CoV-2. So this just tells you that, you know, that kind of establishment is there even in the most basic of organisms. So we'll hold that thought for now, because I'll come back to it later. I'll quickly move over to understanding what genome editing means. So as the name suggests, there are three major aspects to genome editing. One is, and what genome editing broadly means is that you want to make a change. You want to edit the genome. So if you have to edit the genome, then there are three processes. One is that you have to find out where you want to edit. Two, you have to add the modification after you break that part. And then you insert a new genomic sequence. Let's put it this way, you can consider it like a document file or a word processing file, such as an MS Word or something. And you have written an entire document, you have typed a letter, and somewhere in the letter, instead of T-H-E, the, you have written A-H-E, and you need to correct that letter. So what you would do is that you will take your cursor to that point where that mistake is there, you would put a backspace, delete that, introduce a T, and then you will save the file. So if you had to imagine the same system happening inside the organism in the cell, or the DNA of an organism, then you would have to probably build a similar kind of a mechanism biologically. Now, that's simple, but of course, that is only, you know, in the form of a diagram or a cartoon. In reality, this is decades of work, 50, 60 years of work that people have put into to understand what are the elements that are necessary in order to make this so precise. So therefore, there are more important questions to address. One is that where do you want to do this genome editing? Are you thinking of doing it in the cells, which are of the body, or in the sperm cells or the ovum cell, or in the spermatogonial cells? Or any such germline cells, or are you thinking of doing this in the embryo, such that the baby who is born is actually edited? Secondly, how does one do this? Does this involve putting the genome editing components directly inside the cells, or taking the cells out and doing the editing and then returning them? And most importantly, what are we doing this genome editing for? Is it for disease correction, which is an absolutely, you know, valid reason, because you want to have a disease-free organism? Do you want to do a disease prevention? Well, sometimes it's valid, sometimes not, because our understanding of diseases are not absolutely clear. So in the process of doing something, we might end up doing something different. What about improvement and design? Well, those are the areas where there's a lot of debate, and understandably, there is a moratorium. Because whenever you go into aesthetics, and here we are talking about molecular aesthetics where you have the possibility of doing things which would make an organism different from the rest of the others, then of course one has to think that, you know, with so much of power that one can do, where does one put a full stop? Where does one put a comma, and so on? So I'll come into all that, but just to, you know, understand what how this actually happens, there's a small video taken from an educational site. This is just to put it into perspective. This is a bacteriophage putting its genomic material. It almost looks like an alien spaceship. It really looks like that if you look under a cryo-EM. And this is the genetic material which goes into a bacterial cell. And as you will see, the bacteria will quickly harness an RNA complex. These are the two single-stranded RNAs and a protein, which is a Cas protein, and it goes and, you know, interacts with that invading DNA which has come in. That's how it does that. And the RNA base pairs with the DNA one by one. It finds a match, tells it, this is a DNA that has come earlier, so this must be a viral or a foreign DNA, and it chops it. And this way, the viral DNA cannot, you know, replicate, and the new cannot be formed. Immunity goes on. Now imagine you take the same complex and you put it inside a human cell. So that's what is being done over here. In this case, the RNA is now known as what is called a guide RNA, because it guides the Cas9 complex. It is put inside a human cell, as you can see, it's going in. And then based on the sequence that you put on the guide RNA, it can go and specifically interact with a target DNA sequence. Again, one by one, it tries to, you know, match. If it finds a match, it breaks that DNA precisely at a particular location. Now, once the DNA is broken, the cell, of course, tries to repair it. And how it does a repair, I will explain in a next slide. But in principle, you can actually put a foreign DNA piece in that region. And that foreign DNA piece can be supplied externally. So as you will see over here, there is a DNA break, and that break has to be repaired by the cell's own repair machinery. And somewhere there is a foreign DNA piece that is floating around, which will be there. You can see it. It's coming in. If this foreign DNA piece has got some amount of homology, then it can be precisely integrated. So that's really powerful, because that means that you can change the DNA, what was existing, to something else. You can correct a mutation, you can introduce something, you can change cells in stem cells, you can change it in somatic cells, you can create organisms. You can do this in a single cell level. You can create organisms which are mutants and genetically engineered, and so on. So, this is the whole blueprint of the complex that goes in. There is a Cas protein, and then there is a guide RNA, which goes and specifically recognizes a target region, then makes a break on the DNA. And once that break gets repaired, that's when the possibility of making changes happens. So I told you about DNA break and DNA repair. This is a big story in itself. Normally, what happens is that when the cell undergoes a DNA repair, or a DNA break, it tries to, you know, somehow repair this break by, let's say, brute force. It tries to bring the ends of the chromosomes together and, you know, just puts a glue and a molecular glue, if I might say, and tries to seal the ends. And that is most of the times is fine, but sometimes it also leads to mistakes, and these mistakes are called insertions and deletions. That's a non-homologous end joining process of repair. But on the other hand, if one provides a very tiny template which has got certain amount of homology with the target site, then this template can be integrated into the site very, very precisely. This is called a homology directed repair, or an HDR. And that's the powerful element of genome editing, because you can imagine there was a mutation that was a disease that caused disease. And now this mutation can actually specifically be corrected using a template which has the right version of that gene. So that's a really powerful technique. And you can take that and put that into a large number of different substrates in a way, because you can put that into, let's say, the sperm, and you can generate a second generation of organisms, in this case, primates, who are genetically edited, and you can have them, have expressed certain types of characteristic features, certain types of mutations, and so on. So that's the power. And it's actually very, very simple to design and execute, because all you need is an RNA sequence, which can specifically go and recognize a sequence on the DNA. You can take this on a much, much larger scale and even do things like genome screening. Let's say where you have all the 20,000 genes or all the 100,000 non-coding RNAs knocked out, because CRISPR can actually allow you to knock out genes and proteins very, very easily. And you can understand what is the role played by individual knockouts. You can understand how certain drugs can actually work epistatically when there is the activity of the drug is exacerbated in the presence of certain types of mutations when you combine these kind of screens together. And this is very commonplace nowadays to do such kind of screening. Since this whole complex goes and binds to DNA, you can imagine that using a fluorescent tag on the CRISPR complex, you can actually light up a portion of DNA, and you can follow the chromosomal movements. In this case, TRF2, which is a telomere binding protein, is co-localizing with the CRISPR complex, which is targeting the telomere. So you can actually look at how chromosomes move, map their movement, and understand how these dynamics play a role in the normal cell progression and so on. So you can actually map DNA. And you can also do more crazy things where you can make CRISPR-based genetic circuits. I mean, some of you might have actually heard about logic circuits in computer technology, the AND gates or NOT gates. You can also build similar kind of circuits inside the cell. It's a type of synthetic biology where you can have a product of gene A influencing the product of gene B, and that influencing the product of gene C, and you can just keep on building such kind of things. This is actually very, very interesting, because if you want to make your cells respond to certain cues in a very, very precise manner, you can develop circuits to actually tell them what to do at what point of time, and CRISPR actually allows you to do such kind of experiments. So the overall portfolio of CRISPR is huge, as you can understand. And that also means that, you can imagine there are do's and don'ts. Of course, there are a lot of things that can be done, but how many things should be done is the question. And this got really highlighted last year when a scientist in China actually did human embryonic gene editing, Jin Kui. And there was a lot of question about, what can be done, what should be done, rather. In this case, he defended saying that, we were trying to make babies who are born, actually, to be resistant to HIV or AIDS. HIV infection or AIDS. But for example, it was not clear whether these mutations could lead to something else, such as a West Nile virus infection, or even the ethics surrounding it, whether an unborn individual who has not been consulted for genome editing should be subject to such kind of experiments. So there's a lot of debate, and there should be a lot of debate, because it's extremely powerful technology, and laws need to be continuously evaluated in the light of what public opinion and the opinion of scientists. But it's needless to say that, the evolution of CRISPR systems, there's an infinite scope of applications. We've come a long way from the 80s when, certain types of CRISPR elements were seen in curd in a Danish factory, till the time that we are imagining that the first clinical trials therapeutic for hemoglobinopathies in the case of sickle cell anemia was tried last year. And I should have put the New England Journal of Medicine article that came just last week here, but which shows that there is huge promise with this particular therapeutic approach. So to put it simply, the patient's blood was taken out and then it was subjected to genome editing and then was returned to the patient. And then one already sees that several episodes of disease phenotype, which is very consistent with sickle cell anemia, has now not been seen at all. So expectedly, whatever was you know, hypothesized in terms of the cure, in terms of curing the disease permanently, one has already begun to see it. Of course, it will take a long-term follow-up to understand what are the complications that might happen as a result of genome editing. But these are very, very you know, promising signs how genome editing would go ahead in the next few years. And there are a lot of companies, CRISPR Therapeutics, Vertex, these are some of the first companies who are doing these trials elsewhere. But, you know, sickle cell anemia is not a disease is just not a disease of the West. So if you look at this picture over here, you can actually see that India is perhaps even redder than most countries in terms of incidence of sickle cell anemia. And unfortunately, most of the sickle cell patients come from tribal areas, areas which are not really exposed to very high quality healthcare, poor people, and so on. So the, and some studies estimate that the highest number of sickle cell carriers can actually be from India. So sickle cell anemia is caused by single mutation causing the conversion of glutamic acid to valine, GAG to GTG. And when I started my lab, which was in 2069, this was the first kind of big project that we started working on as a part of the CSIR sickle cell anemia mission 2017. So the first phase was completed this year, and now we are entering into the second phase. And the idea was that could we develop a proof of concept correction of sickle cell anemia mutation in Indian patient derived stem cells. So if you are wondering what this has all to do with Feluda and the SARS-CoV-2 detection, this will all build up into this because that was the background for Feluda as well. So to cut a long story short, what we identified was an alternate Cas protein from the bacteria. I mean, of course, the Cas9 was already known, but we extensively characterized to show that it could be used for genome editing from a bacteria protein from a bacteria called Francisella novacida Cas9. But not only did we show that it could actually correct the mutation in patient-derived induced pluripotent stem cells, we had a very interesting finding. We found that if you want to do genome editing using homology directed repair, which is a precise version of correction, then the FN Cas9 was actually doing pretty well. It was either equal or even better than what is the currently used Cas protein from Streptococcus pyogenes. But more importantly, it had a very, very distinct method of mismatch discrimination. So you can imagine that when you do a PCR reaction, polymerase chain reaction, many people would have done this in the audience. It is not always that you always get a single band on the gel, which is the amplified product. If you're very lucky and your primers are very good and specific, yes, you do. But oftentimes you also get several other bands. And this happens because something known as off-targeting or off-target binding or amplification. So CRISPR works on the principle that you have this guide RNA of 20 bases, which goes and matches to something else in something in the genome. But you can imagine that if there is some kind of a bulge because there is one mismatch, two mismatch, or three mismatch, it might often also bind to such areas and cause editing at these off-target locations. That's called off-targeting, and that's a huge problem, particularly if you think about therapeutic genome editing, because you do not want to edit hemoglobin B and end up editing P53, let's say. So what we found was that FN-Cas9 was very intolerant to substrates that were different by a single mismatch. And the reason for this intolerance was because it did not bind to such kind of substrates. It actually got evicted from the site. So that was very interesting finding. And we published this in PNAS last year. It was highlighted as one of the main articles that in that issue. But this was very academic because here we had a disease to cure, and we got editing in iPSCs, but iPSCs would not be the way to go into clinical trials. So if we had to really bring this to clinic, that was always the motivation as far as the study was concerned. Where do we have to go from there? And as it appears that, you know, there are there's a consensus that if you correct approximately 10 to 30% of the cells, in this case hematopoietic stem cells of a patient, and you are able to return that into the patient, then you would be probably able to get rid of the disease permanently. So that is a number that people have understood from different sources, and we felt that we were still quite behind that, because in iPSCs the correction was very low. We did not know in HSCs how much the correction would be. Now we know, of course, but that there was a lot of scope for improvement. But then, you know, doing such kind of studies over a long period of time and so on, what are the chances that we would be able to actually take this into a translatable product to the clinic, so that a patient can benefit from such kind of thing? Here, remember, we are talking about curing the disease permanently. And if it works for sickle cell, it could also work for a large number of other diseases. And that was the same time that actually came, you know, across this very nice article in the New England Journal of Medicine, which talked about a tiny kid who was diagnosed with a rare genetic disease in 2016. And by 2018, the clinical, you know, all the preclinical trials, the safety, toxicological studies, everything was completed in the terms of an oligonucleotide therapy. And the first patient dosing was given in 2018. So, which basically told us that this was an N of one trial, because there was a single individual who needed that therapy. This basically told us that, you know, if you have an entire system working together in different formats, whether it be doing a preclinical, whether it be doing a clinical, whether it would be clinicians, scientists, doctors, everybody coming together, then such kind of a dream of correcting diseases or providing therapy to individuals is indeed possible. But as a scientist, what would you need to initiate all these things is that we would need a variant of this Cas9, which would be of very high efficiency, because you want the maximum correction to happen. We would also need appropriate vectors for delivery, meaning that we need to have some kind of a vector by which you could actually put it inside, because this is not cultured cells anymore. Here we are talking about patient cells. So it has to be safe and it has to be efficacious. And most importantly, we need to have robust preclinical data to actually convince the regulators to say that, yes, we can, you know, think about doing a clinical trial of some kind in India. So, of course, you know, my lab works principally on the CRISPR biology, so it would not be possible to do everything here. So we teamed up with some of the best people. So at University of Tokyo, Osamu Nureki helped us with actually developing what is known as enhanced FN-Cas9, or engineered versions of FN-Cas9. A grad student went there, and within 2 months we were able to make this protein. We have very, very exciting and interesting data from there. I'll not show that here, because that also undergoes a little bit of IP issues. There's, of course, at UCSF and now also at Washington University in Seattle, we started working with people who are really pioneers. Here we're talking about Mark Walters, David Martineau did work in the field of correcting the first beta hemoglobinopathies, and try to see if one can use these CRISPR systems to generate some kind of a preclinical data. With Anand Swarup at NIH, we started making, initiated the development of adeno-associated viral vectors where this can be delivered. And what I have not shown over here is with Andre Lieber at Seattle, we started working on developing adeno vectors for generating vectors that can be used to enter human cells and then do the correction. So all this is ongoing, and we have very, very exciting data. Unfortunately, I'll not be able to show here this work. Maybe on a different platform. But as a byproduct of all these things, we understood that, yes, we have a very interesting Cas9 in hand, and this Cas9 has got very interesting properties of discriminating between a target and an off-target. So that's the story of CRISPR diagnostics. And like the rest of the work, this also is done with a fantastic friend, philosopher, you know, kind of a mentor, and a colleague, Dr. Shobhik Maiti. We share a big group together. I mean, he brings in his nucleic acid biophysics knowledge. I bring in the molecular biology tools, and together we attempt some of these problems. So what is Feluda? Basically, Feluda's full name is FN-Cas9 Editor Linked Uniform Detection Assay. Why Feluda? Because when we started work on this, there were complementary technologies using Cas13 and Cas9. 12, working on the principle of these kind of collateral cleavage, which were called Sherlock, Detector, Holmes. Sherlock was from MIT, Detector was from Berkeley, Holmes was from labs in China. So we wanted to give it an Indian flavor. And when you have two Bengalis in a group, where do you start? You actually start with something which came immediately was the F and Cas9 started with F. So, you know, Feluda immediately followed. So the principle of Feluda is that you have a Cas which is so specific that it can discriminate between a point mismatch. So can you use it to detect two nucleotide sequences which are one mismatch away? If you can do that and you can develop it into a readout which could be on the gel, which could be on a capillary electrophoresis or a fluorescence-based readout or a lateral flow readout, then what you can actually do is you can replace the need for sequencing for genotyping. Sequencing still is expensive. It's not something that, you know, you can do in a village in Tripura or Bengal. You would still have to get these things up to the nearest sequencing, and it could be costly. We know it is costly. So one, it has to be robust. It has to be point of care. It has to be non-expensive. And effectively, if you can do it for one, you could do it for any mutation on DNA and RNA. And it, in principle, it seems to be possible. But in order to make it possible, we had to figure out what would be that kind of a design that would allow this Cas protein to specifically recognize one substrate and not recognize another substrate which was mismatched by one nucleotide. And it turns out that if you make a synthetic mutation in addition to that point mutation which exists at a very precise position, which is in the second and the sixth position of the guide RNA, then you get a completely polarizing opposite kind of effect on the cleavage property. So here, what you see over here on the left is a wild type sequence, on the right is a sickle cell anemia sequence. GAG gets converted into GTG. If you keep that T fixed and you move with a different mismatch in every position of the guide RNA, then at some point, which is marked with that red box over there, the wild type substrate would be almost not cleaved at all, whereas the sickle cell substrate would be completely cleaved. So the point, what we wanted to do is that can we now convert this into some kind of a readout, which will allow us to distinguish between wild type and sickle cell substrate. Of course, it can be done on the gel and it works robustly. But very interestingly, it has nothing to do with the sickle cell anemia sequence, but rather the information is coded in the protein, which means that whatever be the sequence, whatever be the substrate, whether it is a DNA or an RNA, you can use the same principle to design a guide RNA and able to dissect a point mutation. We converted into even a fluorescent version of it, where we played around with the chemistry, made biotin probes, use a Cas9 recombinant GFP molecule, and you can convert this using such that the Cas9 will not bind in the case of a mismatch, or it will bind if in the presence of no mismatch, and then you can distinguish that using a signal, using a detector. And we did this on blinded samples from a village in Chhattisgarh, and we found that it has 100% concordance even taken in identifying carriers of a mutation, which means 50% of the alleles are mutated and 50% is not. So that was very, very useful, because carrier screening is a very, very important aspect of stopping the spread of such genetic disorders, because you can genetically counsel some individuals. You can tell them the need for family history and understanding who should be planning a baby based on the type of mutations and so on. With Govind Makharia at Ames, we found that you could actually use it in Helicobacter pylori detection. So Helicobacter pylori causes peptic ulcer. And normally, there are certain types of mutations in the Helicobacter pylori strain, which makes them rifampicin resistance. These are first line antibiotics given against this bacteria. And normally, what happens is that the patient comes to the OPD, the doctor takes a scrape from the stomach, cultures it for 2 days, 3 days on rifampicin plate, and then is able to give an antibiotic, during which the patient, of course, is in a lot of pain. Feluda can do this all within half an hour to 1 hour, because all you need is to simply take some amount of DNA from that scrape, do a Feluda reaction, figure out what is the signature, and you can give the possible antibiotic that should be going on with it. And we also, of course, we found out a way by which if you put in a PAM sequence, PAM is a protospacer adjacent motif sequence, in the primer, you would not need the mutation that you want to detect to be present present in the vicinity of a pen. So this actually makes it much more widespread. So you can in principle target any mutation in the DNA in the human genome or the RNA for that matter. Earlier in the year, Dr. Shobhik and several students, they actually visited a village in Chhattisgarh, in Raipur, and tried to see, you know, how things are happening on the field. So here, what we show here is a solubility test. Normally, what the screening camps do for sickle cell anemia is that they take a prick, they get the blood out, and then they do the swift test coagulation, which gives some kind of an idea about the status of the disease based on the solubility. However, it of course doesn't tell us about the genetic sequence which is present in the individual, whether or not that person is a carrier and so on. It's a very crude test, so it still has to be sent to a different lab to do another assay. And as you see in this picture over here, this is from a tertiary care center. It's a school, primary school, and the children are waiting in a queue to have their fingers pricked and the blood to be taken out. And one of these children who doesn't have a shoe in, she's slightly looking with apprehension at the possibility of having her finger pricked. And she doesn't seem to be too thrilled, if you ask me. So we came up with the idea that we can do all this by just asking the kids to spit into a tiny tube. And molecular biology textbooks from 70s and 80s, you know that if there are certain types of buffers present in the tube, it will lyse the cell, DNA comes out, and then the felula can be done absolutely non-invasively. And this is what we are kind of now taking forward for other diseases and so on. But yes, that was where we were at the beginning of the pandemic. And the pandemic came and of course changed everything. Life turned upside down. One of the things that we understood at that point of time, which is in January, is that if we could detect nucleotide sequences which were different by one base mismatch, we could also potentially detect a viral RNA signature, because that would be 20 bases of RNA converted to DNA. So we came up with the idea of a FN-Cas9 editor linked assay for SARS-CoV-2, where once you have the RNA, we are undergoing a reaction called RT-PCR, not to be confused with real-time PCR, but a reverse transcription PCR. And this RT-PCR happens in a single step, where the RNA is converted to cDNA and is amplified using specific primers that are biotin labeled, and the amplicons are all biotin labeled. And then when you have the Cas9 RNP finding out precisely the sequence that it is asked to, which is in this case specific to SARS-CoV-2, we combine a little bit of paper strip chemistry with it, and then the readout looks a bit like this, where you have a test band developing a test line and a control band which comes positive in every strip basically. The whole process can be done within 45 minutes to 50 minutes, starting from the RNA. It requires a normal PCR machine. It doesn't require a quantitative real-time PCR machine, which generally come somewhere around 20 lakhs or plus minus 5 lakhs. A normal PCR machine is way cheaper than that. And of course, it's economical, it's rapid, and it can actually give you semi-quantitative readouts. I'll show you in a moment how that happens. And in order to make this work in terms of a paper strip, we played around with the chemistry of commercial paper strips, which contain gold nanoparticles in such a way that these gold nanoparticles can now recognize the Cas9, and the whole stuff can flow up. And then because there is a biotin at the end of the DNA substrate, I won't go into more details because I think you can always read the manuscript, which is in public domain. But in the end, this is what you get. You have a positive sample giving a signal and a negative sample which will be not giving a signal at the test band. And Feluda, there is also it's a sacrilege for a Bengali to not have Topshelo and Jatayu assisting Feluda, because that's a part of the folklore, right? So we have a Topshe, which we developed with Adiuvo in Chennai, which is a smartphone app which takes a picture and basically tells it's machine learning dependent, so it has been trained over several thousands of samples to give a signal output. And you can actually go down to just a few copies of the virus, as you can see over here, in terms of sensitivity. And Jatayu is actually a web tool, is the junction for the target design for your Feluda assay, analysis and target design, which is it takes in a sequence and it is independent of SARS-CoV-2, so you can put in any sequence of that you want, and it will give you the Feluda primers and guide RNA design for designing your own Feluda experiment to make sure that you can detect a point mismatch. I did show you a PCR machine. This is actually the cost of the reagents in the lab level. So it costs something around 400, 500 rupees in terms of reagent costs. I did show you a PCR machine, but in a Feluda version 2, you actually do not need a PCR machine. You can combine isothermal PCR, one-pot reaction to get the samples. We are working very rapidly to try to bring this also into public domain at some point. You know, this is a small, I won't take more than maybe 2 minutes. So if I have a couple of minutes, I'll just finish this. So this whole experience is a very interesting experience because normally when we think about, you know, translating ideas, we generally look at let's say timelines, which are in years. The vaccine also, and also in our case, in a very small manner, the Feluda experience actually showed us some very interesting things. One is that, you know, the translation of an idea to a product has to go through several phases, and in case of a pandemic, all this had to be pushed into a very, very short deadline. So it got a lot of attention, it got a lot of media attention, which, I mean, there was more distraction than anything else, because I think there are a lot of interesting technologies elsewhere in the country also, which sometimes also requires a lot of attention. But very hearteningly, once we got the approval, and not us in this case, it's the commercial partner, which is Tata Medical Diagnostics, it was considered to be an equivalent of RT-PCR. So one who does a Feluda reaction would not have to do this RT-PCR again to confirm it. So this is just a timeline to show that, you know, we thought about having such a thing in January. 28th January is precisely the date, and I want you know, just to, as a proof here, that's when we formed a group within our lab members. This was even before the first case of coronavirus was reported. So we really started early. By March, we had a working prototype, filed a patent in the end of March. We licensed it to Tata Sons. They actually formed a new company called Tata Medical Diagnostics, went through all the, you know, scale up, consumables, recruitment, everything. By September, they got a DCGI approval for market release. And I'm told that it is already in a lot of, you know, it's in a B2B model, so they are probably working with several of these diagnostic companies, Apollo included, and that has started in some cities. You know, this is just to show, I think this is not required, but this is just to show how the lateral flow works, where you know that the liquid goes up and then you will have a band on the top, which is the control band. If you can see that band over here, and then later on, in the case of a positive sample. Interestingly, this was our first sample which we got from NCDC in March. So it was a kind of a eureka moment to see it working. Of course, it went through several months after that, and like I said, that this approved in September. But one of the lessons that we learned is that, you know, you might have a product which works in the lab, but you need a partner to actually go and take that into the public domain. And sometimes our languages that we speak are very different, and you need really interpreters, very good Google Translate, to understand, because what a corporate or a company wants is sometimes a little bit different from what a scientist actually looks at. So one of the things that we learned is that the quality of the PCR reagents, how we get these things, you know, how we source them, is very, very important. And it's almost like garbage in, garbage out. You provide bad quality reagents, you have bad quality outputs. And the more and more that we see this in the field, with several types of RT-PCR kits, antigen kits, this becomes more and more prominent, that, you know, the quality is directly proportional to the pricing. One of the other things is that, you know, we had a new test, which was CRISPR test. I think, if I'm not mistaken, this is the first approved CRISPR paper test. There are also FDA EUAs for other CRISPR tests based on fluorescence. And when you have a new test like this for detection, there is a question about what do you use it to benchmark, or what do you benchmark, you know, use a test to benchmark this? Because you can use the quantitative PCR, which is often termed as a gold standard, but sometimes when in our own practical experience, they might not even qualify for a bronze standard, depending upon the kit of quantitative PCR that you are using or the quality of the RNA that has been extracted. So all these things have actually went forward, and we have now done, you know, thousands of such reactions to really understand what are the challenges in making a test which works in the lab to actually work in the hands of a third party every single time. That has been a lesson. The lesson that we learned is that, you know, our students are our biggest asset. You know, this whole work about Feluda was done in a span, as you could see, of a few months by individuals who actually stayed back during the pandemic, you know, contributed to this whole process. Almost 50 to 60% of them have actually turned COVID positive at some point, but really believing that at some point, you know, they could, the technology that they are working on could be translated. I think it's with all the problems that PhD students face sometimes, you know, with fellowships not coming in hand on time and so on, this is probably a time for us to just, you know, think back sometimes even at the regulator levels that how do we actually help the student communities, because they are really bright minds, they are really motivated people who can do this. The third thing that we learned is that, you know, raising a child, they say, requires a village. If you want to bring a product to market, and that also in a few months, it actually requires sync at levels from the smallest office to the highest office. It could be simply the person who handles logistics for getting our primers from the airport to the institute versus, even the director or the director general of the entire organization. Everybody has to be in sync in order to make sure that you can put this ahead. When Feluda got so much of attention, like I said, it was a distraction. There was a lot of people who also took up to social media knowingly, anonymously, and so on. And I understood what would be the cruel nature of social media. At that point of time, I would think that, you know, what it means. Nowadays, I don't care so much. But this was something that we also learned. Interestingly, you know, science is even getting so much of brickbats. That's also very heartening. And particularly heartening is to understand that social media can also make science accessible to public like no one else. And sometime in September, in Twitter, Feluda was trending after Sri Krishna and press freedom in number 15. That, as a scientist, if that doesn't make one happy, what does? And when Shashi Tharoor actually puts in his non-bombastic words a comment for something which is coming out of science from India, that's very, very motivating. So that actually, if you really think about it, the entire pandemic situation and now CRISPR, Feluda, vaccines, all these things have become household names. People are talking about them like no other. And I am actually being invited by BITM to give you a talk on all this. That tells you that, you know, it has championed science. And that has been the best part of 2020, if you think among all the morbidities that has happened. But more importantly, pandemic is the mother of invention. It definitely gives you a kick in the back. And this is just a teaser of what we have been doing over the last few months after the first version of Feluda has come out. The idea is to make Feluda more point of care, where you could potentially do Feluda at the local dispensary at home, even if possible, depending upon whether the regulators clear such versions and so on. But effectively, for that you would need to keep on innovating, and I think the students have done fantastic work there as well. We plan to have something very soon out where you would actually do not need any kind of equipment at all, so a lab kind of a setting. This is just a version which shows that in principle you can do the PCR inside your elbow. That's how the PCRs are being done now, using isothermal amplification. Nothing that we developed, it's something that is already known, but you know, to bring them all into a context. And you can do this PCR inside the elbow for 10 minutes and you add the buffer, the strip buffer, and then you add the paper strips. And then you can have a readout, something like this. So those are the things or the innovations that need to keep on happening if we have to think about return to schools, return to malls and labs and all the things that are necessary in order to make normalcy back. So with that, I'd like to thank all of you. You know, it's a big lab that we have with Dr. Shobhik. There's a lot of people to thank, really. One slide is not enough. A lot of clinical collaborators, a lot of scientific collaborators. We are very generously funded by different organizations. And I think Tata Medical and Diagnostics have been very instrumental in taking this forward. I think they are working at a very rapid pace, considering the demand that of Illuga kits. Which I think they're bringing, you know, they have started bringing out in phases. So we are also looking forward with equal interest and curiosity to see how that works out. So thank you. If you have any questions, I would be more than happy to take them now.
Thank you, sir. It is such an informative session. Actually, now, as you say, like, you know, CRISPR-Cas, now everybody hears very often, but today you have taken to the place, like, you know, what actually happening in the field of science, actually, is how it works and what are its applications and what difficulties are there. And you have given all the information, that means what's been happening for all these, you know, days in the field of science. And thank you very much. And congratulations for you and your team for developing such a, you know, first of its kind, you know, CRISPR-based, you know, test kit for the COVID. Of course, to do this kind of work, obviously, you know, some sort of hurdles will be there. You have been crossing all the hurdles. I think you are, about to come your kit, hopefully, and it will help solve the so many problems. Now, here I have a few questions, sir. So I'm attending those. This is not exactly this one question is from Saptarsi, not exactly related to the CRISPR-Cas, but he asked that how SARS-CoV-2 virus is decoded by ACE2 protein.
I don't know what exactly the question means here. ACE2 protein is, of course, something that the virus requires for you know, in its effective pathway. So I'm not very sure what the question is here. Is it you know, what is the significance of the protein, or whether it is used as detection? So if you can clarify, then maybe. But it is not relevant in the case of Illuga. Yeah.
Yes. Next, another question is the relevant question is: do you believe this? This question is from Gargi. Do you believe this has positive or negative impacts on our society, world?
So if your question is about CRISPR in general, of course, it has a you know, positive impact on the world, because you see, you know, there will be certain diseases that will probably be cured very soon. So you know, there is nothing or certain diseases which will where the life expectancy was lower, which would be definitely increased longevity. So yes, that is definitely a positive thing. But of course, looking at the experiments that the Chinese scientists did, and you know, all the ethical questions surrounding CRISPR, you can imagine that you know, it's like, you know, with great power comes great responsibility. I think that is the same in the case of CRISPR as well. So how you use it will determine what the outcomes are going to be.
Similar, another question, sir. What is the validation accuracy of the rapid CRISPR-based diagnostic test for the COVID-19? That means that Illuga.
So if you're asking about Illuga, I think this was done by DCGI separately for the kit, the Tata MD kit, and it came up with a 96% sensitivity and 98% specificity. Of course, anything above 95% is like, it's a range, as you might know in biology. So in our hands, it can come up at somewhere around 97% sensitivity, 100% specificity in certain days. So yeah, it's around about that numbers. Yeah.
One more question from Riddhi. Besides the setbacks you mentioned, what are the biggest challenges you faced while developing Illuga?
To be very honest, I think the lockdown was a huge challenge, because procuring items during the lockdown is a big problem. And I think, again, like when I said that sometimes we keep on taking these things lightly, but the amount of synchronization between different offices, whether it is the highest office of the government to the simple courier company who delivers primers, to make this work has been quite amazing. In the case of IGIB, that's why I said that it is an entire institute, an entire organization who has actually developed to do that, in my opinion. We, of course, obviously we put the brains behind it. The other thing that, you know, like I said, that we would have students turning COVID positive because we were handling, you know, very, very infective materials right from day one. So that also had a little bit of setback and so on. When you have, you know, somebody doing an experiment has having to be replaced. Years. And of course, the final thing is that when you have a technology in the lab, how do you put that to a different company? And company people have to build around that technology. So you have to work together with them. We had Tata people coming here and getting trained, and it's a very nice eye-opening experience. I would say that, you know, we sometimes talk in a language which is very, very lab level. To put that and translate that into a systematic manner where, you know, a company can come and pick that up and make their product is something that we also learned during the process. So I would not say challenges, because we were very motivated throughout. We wanted it to work because we thought that the technology was very good in terms of you know, the abilities that it has. Of course, every technology has its shortcomings. We know that, and that's why we are keeping on trying to, you know, make it better. But we will see. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Sir, questions are there, but those are regarding the vaccination. I think Dr. Srikanto would like to.
On behalf of, thank you, Devajyoti. On behalf of Sishuj, I would like to thank Dr. Chakraborty for his fantastic lecture and also sharing with us the background story. It was really a learning experience for us also. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Also, wish him best for his future endeavors. Okay, now I would also like to take the opportunity to thank Birla Industrial and Technological Museum, Kolkata, for this venture. Special thanks to Director Sir and Mr. Srinu Apikonda. I would also like to thank President, Executive Committee members, advisors, and all other members of CCHUGE for making this program a grand success. Thank you so much. Mr. Srinu, please.
Thank you.
So just before concluding the session, just I have a query that I would like to ask. As you say that CRISPR is in a very specific and it has reduced the off-site and not target issues. But still, since then it was first came 2012 and thereafter it's been 80 years. And now still, are there any again off-site issues, sir, with this present this also?
So I think as if you follow the science, the off-targeting has been pretty much resolved, I would say, to manageable levels. Because you have to always think about in terms of what are we trying to do here? You can keep on making a system better, but there will be that 1%, 2% which you cannot reach. If it was possible, then you would have a perfect machine, which doesn't happen in physics. It doesn't happen in biology as well. So you have to just live with certain things. And why I'm saying that is, a human genome is so fragile that by the time that I started this talk and by the time that I'm now ending it, we would have undergone billions of mutations already. So about mutations that are CRISPR related, and if you put all that into context, there will be mutations that will happen. Question is, how safe is that mutation, and whether as a parent you take the decision that your child who is suffering and who would probably not have more than 4-5 years to live, whether you are willing to elongate that life by 5-10 years. And I'm telling you very practical situations, because we keep on meeting such parents, we keep on meeting doctors and clinicians. So a technology or a therapy which gives hope in some form is always preferable, of course, under the, it has to be very, very carefully monitored and evaluated, just like any other thing.
Thank you, sir. Sir, this year is the Nobel Prize, and it is very good news that this chemistry Nobel Prize is for the first time it is gone for the entire women team. And indeed, it is a good inspirational message for the all the women who have been working in the field of science. It is a very, very good motivation. And similarly, many people, many students would like to choose as a science as a career, like who want to have a rewarding career like you, like, you know, some of them very much inspiring to become scientists, like, you know, in the field of research. And could you give some, like, you know, what is the procedure and what sort of attitude one has to develop? This is for especially high school students, because high school students would be watching this program, and even for the graduate students, like from your side.
So I probably am not a right person to already give messages, because I think I'm still very young that way. But I mean, if somebody has a curiosity, if somebody has a question in mind, then such a person is a scientist, born scientist. And you do not need a degree to be a scientist. If you start questioning things around you with an inquisitive mind, and just not question, stop there at questioning, but also try to answer that, then the foundations of being a scientist is already laid. And of course, you know, since you need to put in a kind of an official tag on it, you need to go through certain types of processes, whether it could be getting a higher education. Normal procedure would be to get a doctorate in science, a PhD, and then you know, you can there are a lot of places in the country where PhDs are conducted, very nice places, where basic science, applied science, translational science. NIBMG is of course one of the leading things over there, in terms of taking this also at the level of genomics. So really opportunities are a lot, and I'm very happy to say that more than half of my lab are actually women. So they really drive the project forward, there is no doubt about that. So I think, you know, 2020, like many other things in science, definitely it has championed this cause, and it's really up for us to you know, make sure that we build on that. That's very important. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Sir, with this, you know, would like to conclude, but we sincerely express our gratitude, sir, for you, for taking a time out from your busy schedule and joining us today. And really, the field work you have, you know, explained so well, and it is very lucid. I think one can understand very easily. And we are very much grateful to you for having joining us. We look forward to have you with us in our future endeavors. Sir, thank you very much, sir, for joining us.
Thank you very much. Thanks for the invitation.
Thank you for you and your team members for developing such a wonderful kit.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Bye.
And on behalf of PITM, we'd like to express our thanks to Calcutta Consortium on Human Genetics for without any interruption, like, you know, for coordinating and in completion of this program in a successful manner. And we express our gratitude. Thank you very much, sir, Srikanth, sir. And at the end, but you are the most important, you know, for us. Thank you very much for joining us today. And not only in joining, but also being active by posting some sort of postings and all that. Hope you are all, you know, during the pandemic time, taking care of yourself and your family members, and following the new normals. Okay. So do subscribe our BITM YouTube channel and click on the bell icon so that you'll get notified whenever program or otherwise, you know, video upload takes place. And hope you all are taking care of. And with this, I conclude. Thank you very much and joining us.
Thank you, everybody. Bye.